Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, madam, for a very nice introduction. People, this is the first time I am hearing I became an eminent scholar, so thank you very much. I wish some of our University of Pardubice administrators would be here. Before I go into the topic of discussion today, let me follow up a very wise remark of our good friend Willem Derde, because yesterday you have been hearing about the book that we co-edited, Western Foundations of the Caste System. And Willem, sitting next to me, told me, yeah, people, but do you have the book with you? You are talking about the book all the time. Where is the book? So, dear friends, the book is here. Yeah. Well, this is how the book looks like. Of course, there is an access also to PDF version. My little suggestion, if it is feasible, just I can send it around so you can just have a little time. See, as intellectuals, typically we also like to touch books, no? Just go through the pages, have it in hand. So. Okay, I will ask. Good. So. Yeah, we can pass it on. Let's see where the book will disappear. Okay. Now the topic today. The topic I would like to pick up today is from the speculation of scholars in the field of study of India to self-evident truth about caste system as a system. What does it mean? I want to... Oh, let's wait. There are still some people who just came in and are sitting down. So let's have a pause. So what I want to do today is a very simple exercise. First, telling you a bit how smaller countries of European Union, because we are talking about Europe and European Union in relations to India, how smaller countries like my own homeland, Czech Republic, are dealing with the caste and how the talk goes in general. That means what is the general perception of the people, what do you see in media, what do you see in school textbooks. So basically when you come to Europe, one important thing that you as Indians should know, that every European knows that India has caste system and it's something terrible. I'm sorry to say, but that's the reality now we are facing. You know, when I am conducting teaching about traditions in India, I am asking freshmen in BA batch of the study of religions, what do you know about India? And what do you know about so-called religions of India in particular? And they come up with only very few things they know, but caste system is always there. So Europe, when you meet us, typically people in all calls, all occupations, wherever you go, they will start to ask you, sooner or later you will be faced with the question, and how serious is the problem with the caste system? Yeah? How is it really with the caste? So when you go for that, one problem is that generally people have in fact no clue what they are talking of. There is a very muddy and very empty discussion in the public space, especially in media. So I start just with one example, right? In 2015, Czech Republic, our parliament, sanctioned a new law concerning public services, governmental services, and their careers. And one part of the law was giving some boons, benefits for the state bureaucracy in terms of when your children will be born that very day, a father, not only the mother, who is of course obviously out of the work, but the father can take a day off, which is paid, you know, it's like a kind of extra holiday. Few other things like that. This created a lot of discussion, especially liberal parties were against, telling how can you do these things, because private sector cannot and will not offer such boons, but state government and, you know, the bureaucracy will. And one of the top liberal politicians in the country, Mrs. Nemtsova is her name, started to say, we are creating caste system in the Czech Republic by enforcing this kind of law. And this was also one of the headlines going in media. You know? So when you look at other kinds of discussions, finally you realize that when you talk about caste in general and caste system, people get a sense this is some terrible oppressive hierarchy. That's it. Nothing more. Very simple. They have no clue, in fact, even how the idea of caste system emerged, why it is there, how it should be discussed, nothing of the sort. But it's very much present. So when this politician, right, let's say Liberal Party politician, is talking about the fact we are creating caste system in the Czech Republic, of course he does not mean anything about jati. She has no clue what jati is. But she's talking about a kind of hierarchical oppression and creating a privileged group of people in the society. So this is how it ends up. However, it is connected, of course, with the more precise discussion that happened about caste. And this discussion repeats what scholars of Europe has been saying about India for the last 200-300 years, more or less. So this is why I talk about Orientalists. Now, some of you might not be even acquainted with the concept or with the idea. Oriental studies emerged in Europe, let's say at the turn of 18th and 19th century for all that concerns the so-called Orient. So starting from the Middle East and ending with Japan and Indonesia, this all is Oriental studies. And it concerns its languages, partially geography, what we call sociology today, social structure, but also religion. Religion was always important concern of those who were in the field of so-called Oriental studies. And one very important branch of Oriental studies, or shortly Orientalism, is Indology, you know, the studies of India. So there, many experts over decades and even centuries in Europe have been thinking, quite seriously, thinking, what is India like? How does it work? What the society is created of? And this is where we have resources on our today's discussion of so-called caste system. What I want to do now is to encourage you all, not just to listen, but in case you need any clarification, in case you want to raise a question, please do not hesitate to do it even while I am talking. Because sometimes, you know, the idea is lost as I go on and on. So maybe there are some questions right now. What these bloody Czech, Polish, Hungarian, and other smaller nations of Europe think of India? If there are some questions, don't hesitate. We can have a slot for questions, then I can go on. Yeah, are there some questions? Or comments? You can be horrified. I mean, it's horrific. You can say, oh, terrible. That's... No question. Okay. So, but please feel welcome anytime. Good. So yesterday, you had Prakash especially explaining you how the discussion about caste as a system, not just the existence of jatis, but caste as a system, is connected with Hinduism in the Western discussions and how it traveled to India, was taken over by several generations of intellectuals in India. Now, I would like to tell you a bit how, in fact, exactly this discussion emerged. What are the ideas? You know how exactly caste is connected with Hinduism in the perspective of Western scholars. I will show you examples of our own Czech Indology, although from what I know from Germany, Poland, Russia, and of course it's not very much different from what British and French did, right? So the Indology, the knowledge of India, of smaller European nations, what I am finding in my research is in basics completely following the lines of the Western. So British, French, and German doesn't differ in any how significance. And how significantly from what we do, or our previous teachers did. Right, so if you read books, Czech, now I will, for the sake of time, keep only what I did on Czech books. If you read Czech popular, but also scientific studies on Hinduism and caste system, what do you learn? First, our people talk about very tolerant side of Hinduism. You know, basically, they will depict Hinduism as, in one sense, very tolerant religion where you can believe everything and anything in the world. On the other hand, they go on saying that it has a social aspect and this is very rigid. And there you start to be puzzled. You know, how can they reconcile these two things? There are two positions in their discussion that are hardly reconcilable. That's my first point. They are contradictory, as we say. So first part says literally, like my teacher Dushan Bavitel wrote numerous books, and he's saying literally, Hindu can be monotheist, pantheist, polytheist, Marxist, agnostic. And you go on and on, you know, and he can add things and he can change things. So when Europeans read this part of account on so-called Hinduism, they would think, oh, it's such a wonderful religion. In fact, it doesn't prescribe anything for you to believe in. No, and Europe doesn't have things like that. You know, Christianity, all Christian churches will tell you a set of doctrines that you should subscribe to as your articles of faith. This is very crucial. Now, there you learn, you be a Hindu, and I mean, whatever you think doesn't matter, in fact. That's one part of the message, you know, one part of the story. You read a bit further, these books, you realize there is something strange, because the very same scholars who told you there is nothing that can be properly described as a doctrinal core of Hinduism, set of beliefs, they start to in fact search for it, and finally they were successful. They identified the doctrinal core of Hinduism, which is in their mind a law of karman, belief in reincarnation. Some talk about atman, some don't. And some of them are talking about moksha. If you have reincarnation, you should have moksha. This is European understanding. So first problem. They are basically on the one hand saying you believe everything and anything, and then they succeed for you, Indians, to reconstruct what should be the doctrinal core of Hinduism. So there I see a huge potential for developing what we call a discussion on anomalies, you know, the problems of the existent theories or ideas on so-called Hinduism and caste. Now, of course, you start to think, okay, and then how caste is related to this discussion? How does it fit in? This is even more puzzling. When you read properly, the only link seems to be the law of karman, because some of the scholars will tell you that Hindus believe you are born into particular caste because of previous deeds, right? Well, that's for the lifetime, because they are convinced you cannot change your caste. And then if you do proper things, which can be many things, but that doesn't concern us very, very much now, next birth could be better. So that's their understanding. Better in the sense you move up the hierarchy in the caste system. So somebody was, let's say, Vaishya. Okay, if he's good enough, next time Kshatriya, or maybe even a Brahmin, you know, that's the idea. Well, I see some smiles all over. But this is a very serious European attempt to understand you people and your forefathers, what India was like. So this is the only link I am able to find so far in the discussion about doctrinal core. The law of Karman should be determining behavior of people, the belief in the law, so much so that they try to be good in the terms of their particular duties and things, and then hope to be born as better caste next time and proceed, and then finally Brahmin and Moksha. That's their idea. Then of course, when you read further, then comes what already was discussed yesterday, Manu and other Dharma Shastras. So they say, and this is another source of doctrines that I have. Second problem, which I will very briefly describe, if Manu really was such a great influential book in India, law, hidden law, as William Jones used to consider it, you know, the book of the hidden law, of the hidden religion, and Brahmins, through Manava Dharma Shastra, exercised their rule over India for millennia, because this is what our people say. They say Brahmins have been ruling, in fact, India for 3 millennia or more through these Dharma Shastras, and especially Manu. Naturally, there comes a question, how? How did they succeed to do so? What exactly is the mechanism of the rule? How these people can implement, because I mean, you can write any book. See, Martin Farek can suddenly become enlightened or thinks that he is enlightened, and I will write a book of new Hindu law, okay? It will be called Martin Shastra. And then I will be coming across India and saying, yeah, you people follow this book. What will be the result? It's pretty obvious. Nevertheless, it's very similar story that Indology is giving us till today. Somehow, Brahmins succeeded to convince all people all over India to follow Manu, or maybe other Dharma Shastras, yeah? Which is very unclear as an argument. They don't really explain how this so-called priesthood would do that. That's very unclear. It's presupposed that priests has such a special influence in the society that everybody is following the priests. How exactly? Of course, now, empirically talking, look at how many Brahmins groups are there in India. How diverse. So many Brahmins are not really knowing each other across India. They are Brahmins, but I mean, so many of them never met different jatis, like Brahmins of Bengal are hardly coming discussing with Telugu Brahmins, right? There were some pan-Indian meetings and discussions in different traditions, but that's a different thing. So it's very unclear how would this so-called priesthood really implement the Dharma Shastra. And there I am finding another interesting thing, because again, using only one example for the sake of our time, our scholars like Dushans Bavitel, Vladimir Miltner, and a few others, they will tell you in their books and articles, see, Brahmins became the guardians of faith and dogma, and they have been successful in continuing in it for centuries or even millennia. Again, several pages later, the very same authors say literally that in fact, the very same Brahmins, the guardians and even police, some use these very strong terms, you know, policemen of the system, there might be sometimes consulted. Now, when it comes to talk about how empirically jatis work and operate, they describe the so-called jati councils. And there, Dushyant Bhavitel explicitly said, although I said few pages before that Brahmins are the guardians and police of the system, in reality, they might be sometimes consulted. So there you are completely puzzled, right? How is it that the very same people who should influence the power are in fact in practical decision matters of different jatis hardly having a say? How can you then explain the system in these terms? Yeah, sometimes you consult Brahmin. If you don't know, you know, usually you consult family, you consult friends, you consult your community. If you do not know, some people go to Brahmins, true. But some people go to gurus who are not of Brahminical origin, right? Some people do very different things. So, I mean, how can you have it as an interesting and good explanation of what is supposed to be caste system with Brahmins ruling everything, you know? So that's another inconsistency that you can find, a contradiction that you can find in the Indological descriptions of India and the caste system, how it should operate. Okay, I will stop for a while. Some questions, I'm now inviting questions, responses before moving further. People, don't be shy. Mike?
Good morning, sir. This is not really a question. I think it would be a response to one of your questions that you put forward. This is based on my limited knowledge, so please correct me if I'm wrong. You were puzzled as to how the whole of India started following Manusmriti, correct? And how the Brahmins, in your words you said, how the Brahmins convinced everyone else to follow the same. So I think as per my knowledge, Manu is someone who, the first man who was sent from God, right? Yeah. So he was more like a religious entity. And also the Brahmins, as we know, are the priestly caste. So India is basically a very religious country. It's a very religious society. So we believe strongly in religion. And if someone tells us that this is what is prescribed by God, we don't really need a lot of convincing for us to follow it. So if the man who was sent by God puts forward some doctrines that we are supposed to follow, then, I mean, at least this was in the ancient times, then people would follow it blindly because he comes from God, so he would be, you know, God's messenger in that context. And also the priests are, as we know, we consider them God's messengers. So it wouldn't be very hard for the whole country to follow the Manusmriti. This is what I believe is the reason for the whole, for all of us to follow this. So this is what I wanted to share.
Thank you for the question and comment. Now let us think for a while what you just said. You say there is priestly class, right? So Brahmins are supposed to be priestly class. Now what priest does mean for you? I will start with very simple questions. What is priest for you?
The one appointed by God. The one appointed by God to, I don't know, lead someone in their religious path, to lead the people, the lay people.
So, but now look at empirically, when you go around India, your description of priest as somebody who is leading you, maybe to God, maybe to enlightenment, okay, fits to many different groups. I met gurus who were of very different origin. And another part, of course, sometimes when people talk about priesthood, they think these are the people who do the rituals in the temples. This is also this sometimes, you know, talk about as priesthood. Again, if you go around India, many, many of these people are not Brahmins, true or not. Yeah. True. So why should be Brahmins the priesthood?
This is what began in ancient India, sir. Like, even for now, whatever I said just now would not hold good for the modern day India. For in the modern day India, be it any religion, if a priest prescribes something, we will question it. We won't follow it blindly. But I think people in the ancient times...
Oh. Darkness of ancient times, yes.
Yeah. So, in the modern day, I think, yes, there would be a lot of sects that would classify as priests, not just the Brahmins. There would be gurus of other... Mm. I think even... I'm not very sure about this, but even lower castes would have their priests who they would look up to.
Okay.
But back in the day, it was just the Brahmins.
Okay. Now, how do we know?
How do we know what?
How do we know that back in those dark ancient times that we went through just for a second now, all those bloody priests were only Brahmins? How do we know?
That is what our books prescribe to us, because those are the only connections that we have. The Brahmins were a priestly caste. As per the caste system, they were according to the status of priests. So... That's
okay. For me, you know, it's very painful, in fact, to see how you are repeating the story that Europeans cooked up 300 years ago for their understanding India. Because if you read Vedas properly, see, today there is lots of talk about Veda. Hardly anybody is going and reading these things. They pick up only a few shlokas here and there. Little popular description, some watered down version of Indological account, and they think, ah, we know Veda. But if you go and read some parts of the Veda, I mean Samhitas and then later layers, what you find out is that there were apparently groups, and their Brahmins perform Vedic Yajna. Okay. But the very same people are talking about many other groups that did different rituals. There is no guarantee that we are also Brahmins or considered even Brahmins. We have no clue. How do we know? Now I tell you how do we know, because this is what I did in the last decade as one of the topics of my research. I mean, it's not that I started it. I followed up some of the previous research, especially that of the Professor Bala Gangadhar that we were talking about. Europeans coming to India, as Christians, had the very precise concept of priesthood. In fact, you describe it pretty well, which is very interesting, you know. How they are the messengers of God, yeah, this is Jewish and Christian prophets. And how people are following them blindly, this is exactly what Christians were thinking. And when you study Christian history of Europe, its thinking, its inner conflicts and problems, you will understand more how this topic was always in forefront of understanding any society outside Europe. So, Portuguese came, then later Dutch, French, British, others, even few Czechs were in India as missionaries, Jesuits. And those people looking around were thinking, why our message of beautiful salvific sacrifice of Christ is not taken seriously by Indians, you know? Some Indians were telling, yeah, another interesting guru and avatar, wonderful, go ahead, you know. We have our own, you have your own, beautiful. There were different responses in India, but basically the mission of Europe, which was Christianize the world, and it must be, if you are true Christian, you want others to become Christians too, failed. Kept failing for centuries. Thousands and dozens of thousands of people tried to convince India of Christianity. It was failing. So they started to look for the answers. Why is it failing? And their understanding of the world told them, in the history of world, there is God communicating with every nation, in fact. And although we have the fullest revelation in Christ, there were some hints and messengers in others. and we should look for them, but typically there will be those who spoiled it, the priesthood. The priests were, see, in the, let's say, 15th, 16th century Europe, Western Europe especially, there was a huge problem in the church, Christian, Catholic church, Roman church, where many learned people started to look at the institution and its priesthood as parasites. There were all kinds of conflicts. They were involved also in political battles. Some of them were nasty rich. And many people looked at the resources of the early church when Christ died and a few generations after him, and they started to see, no, 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 this is not what Christianity should be like. And there, from this, as the main source, I don't say it's the only source, as the main source, the main impetus, the so-called anti-priesthood movement started in Europe, which ended up as a reformation. Luther, Calvin, you will not understand this without all this, right? So these are European, in fact, ideas about European history. And my question to you is, why are you repeating the story?
Because as per my belief, or as per what most of us have learned, is that the caste system did not, contrary to what you believe, it did not originate because of the English or because of the Western influence.
Huh?
Because the caste system is not made of just the priestly caste. We have other castes as well. And we can see, even in ancient times, there used to be practices of untouchability, which is associated with the lower classes. And these practices were existing in India even before the Western influence. So it is not just the priestly caste, it's the other things also that make us believe that there was a caste system that was present in India.
I think we should clarify one point between us. I'm not talking about the empirical things, like there is evidence of some people not giving water to some others and not some others not touching others. Then you will quote Fa Xian and other Chinese monks coming to India and the thing, right? What I'm talking about is the explanation of these things. How the explanation emerged, you know? Because you can organize these facts and historical little things that Europeans collected throughout centuries in a very different manner. You know, to me today, it's not clear how drinking or not drinking water together has anything to do with caste as a hierarchy. It's very unclear. Well, in fact, some Indian research is showing that within families, people won't drink water from each other. Remember Laukik and Vaidhik division? Possibly you know of it. Here in the South India, as far as I know, it makes sense in some communities, right? So you have it through the families. How does it connect in the jati or caste even? Some Brahmins won't take water from another Brahmins. So, you know, that doesn't explain at all how it should be Brahmin-ruled hierarchy. Not at all, right? You understand what I mean?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay.
And it was not just regarding the drinking of water, and it's not just that Brahmins did not take water from these people. In general, the lowest caste, was looked down upon by other castes as well. So, I do not have references. I have not read up on it as much as you have, sir, but this is my basic knowledge which I put forward. So, basically what I think is untouchability it was associated with the lowest caste, and it is not that they were practicing this against only some sort of people, that Brahmins don't drink water from some other people. No, it is not that. This whole caste as a whole was looked down upon by other castes, and they did not want to be associated with them, and the works that were entrusted to them, like cleaning and things like that, were only very lowly. So,
another question. I enjoyed the conversation, do you?
Yes.
Oh, very good. What about the audience?
Yes.
Very good. We in the Czech Republic have all kinds of problems with gypsy people. You know gypsy people, right? Now we are having a large Vietnamese community, which will be of surprise why the small country like Czech Republic should have hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese coming in. That has historical reasons. Doesn't matter for the point, yeah? Now, just two samples very quickly, then I will go to the point. When I was growing up, we had one gypsy boy in the classroom. For some reasons, many gypsies don't still pick up the typical European teaching system seriously. They have their ways, you know. This is really a community that didn't Europeanize or didn't, I don't know, whatever, Czechize enough. So we had all kinds of problems, you know. There are places in the Czech Republic where people will tell you, don't go there. Gypsies took over that particular part of the city, you know, and things like that. So the point is, many Czechs look down upon gypsies. Is it a caste discrimination or not? Second, Vietnamese, when they came in, their first generation in the beginning of the 90s, they hardly spoke Czech, few words. They were really coming from the country that suffered so heavily from the long war with the US, and then look beforehand, Vietnamese suffered also terribly in the last 100 years. So many of them were trying to find better future in Europe, and it so happened that through communist Czechoslovakia, the channel was open. So many Vietnamese flooded in. They didn't know how to connect, what to do, but worked hard 12 hours a day, 14 hours a day. Finally, they established their little shops. So in Prague, that I knew in the beginning of the 90s, many Czech people, don't go, that is this Vietnamese shop, you know. Vietnamese shop is something, you know, like not that good. And although their shops were very clean, they had good services and everything, that was not the point. Then, when I started my teaching career in 2000, after finishing my master's, there were articles in Prague newspapers, a little uproar started, you know why? Many Vietnamese kids, second generation in the Czech Republic, were doing very well in entrance exams to the prestigious secondary schools of Prague. And Czech parents started to be concerned. You know, how is it that these bloody Vietnamese are now pushing off our kids? Some classes, half of them were Vietnamese, and many Czech kids didn't qualify because Vietnamese performed better in the entrance examination, right? So there are all kinds of things you can talk about in the world, looking up, down on people, and, you know, having all. Why is it a religious caste system ruled by Brahmins? You know, looking down at people is in any society of the world I am aware of. Go to the United States. Some places, they are looking down at black people till today. Or now there is a lot of political correctness, but if you talk to some, depends, but some places in the US, they are still not very happy with what happened 150 years ago. They are looking down at people. That's in any every society. Now, you know, all these things were connected in one story of caste system, and I just tried to show some. It's not all, but some of the problems of the religious explanation of Brahmins organizing it together. And as far as I know, the last note, try to think of some Brahminical groups in today India. Well, I met some people and I had much more stories. Many of them are looked down upon today. So, you know.
One of the main points that I would like to put forward is, in the examples that you gave, it was the Czech people against the Vietnamese people. But here, this is Indians against Indians. So this is what the difference is between, I mean, this is how the caste system, I think, would come into picture. We are looking down upon our own people. So this is because of the, caste system that is prescribed by religion. It's not because they are from a different country. It is these are our own brethren, but you see the difference?
I don't see much difference, but okay. You can talk, these are Czechs and Vietnamese, or Czechs and Czechs. Gypsies have been with us for 1,000 years. They spoke Czech as well as I do. So, yeah, but anyway. Okay, there are Czech people looking down upon other Czech people. There are Germans looking down up Germans. Go to Britain, oh my God. There you will realize what does it mean to look down upon somebody. there are people who will not respond to your greeting because they are of certain origin, certain social status, you know, certain thing. And then,
This would be certain people, right?
Huh?
This would be certain people, like you wouldn't respond to a greeting of certain other people. Here we are talking about a whole class of people, a whole caste of people that you, they are...
I will ask a question. When we are discussing these things, are you getting the point about organizing the facts and the stories and the evidence, let's say, alongside certain idea? Are you getting that point?
Yeah, I do get that point.
Uh-huh.
But it is up to your interpretation. You interpret it differently, I interpret it differently.
Oh, welcome to postmodern world. Everybody has his or her own truth. Very nice, well, thank you. Now, see. What we call scientific enterprise, as it has been built, there are certain aspirations. And the aspiration is that you, when you build up an explanation, let's say theory, not just an idea. I mean, I woke up in the morning, I have so many ideas in my head, does it mean they are scientific? No, very good. So, scientific ideas have certain qualities. There is lots of discussion what kind of qualities it should be, but definitely they should be built as consistent, not against empirical evidence. You know, imagine somebody in the department of physics, for example, doing little optical experiments, and then there is this famous phenomenon of bending of the stick in the water, right? And then you see it. And then they try to explain that, right? Okay. Yeah, they have very good explanation why we are obliged to see things like that. And then somebody will come up and say, no, I have a very different explanation. My explanation is that every morning when you put the stick into the water, it gets so wet that the molecules are getting, you know, more fuzzy and whatever, you know. And this is causing the problem with the vision. And another person will come and say, no, I have a very different explanation. It is because we are drinking too much of lassi. And it affects our sight, right? So you can have any number of explanations, but scientific explanations are prone to testing. And what I'm trying to show you here is how the account of caste as a religious hierarchy in India emerged. How Brahmins are supposed to organize it, rule it, and somehow magically really be the rulers of the country, which in fact they never were and they are not today. And my point is, what you see as an empirical evidence is all against it.
I'd like to give an example, sir. So there have been wars, I don't know, all over the world. Now, this is just an example. So, let's say India had a war with some other country, and India lost the war, but still, we want to change history, so we put it down in... and this has happened, not just here, but many kingdoms have done that. They've rewritten history in a different way, so that people follow it over the years. And the opposite country, the one that actually won the war, they would write history according to their version. So, I think it would be the same in this situation. Here, one side would tell you how the caste system actually originated in India. It is a basic Indian tenet, etc. And on the other side, there would be other writers who wrote that, you know, it's a Western thing and it came because of the influence of the West in India.
So that's not what we are saying. My friend, don't clench into common wisdom ideas. Like victors are those who write histories and things. The nature of the explanation, in fact, has nothing to do with colonialism. It was then developed throughout colonial era. But what we are saying is something very different. Europeans, as Christian culture for now 2,000 years, basically, have been trying to understand other cultures, okay? And in order to understand why they produced certain ideas and descriptions and explanations and even, let's say, theories about other cultures, you have to go back and study and start to understand at least some of the basics of their own, our forefathers and forefathers' discussion, their ideas, their whole framework. Because the point is, some of the questions that they raised make no sense in other cultures. My point is that even would not British won, or they might lose at Mysore, you know, they might lose other battles with Marathas or others, we don't know, possible. But my point is, even if they didn't win all over it, maybe they would rule only half of India, so what? Doesn't matter. No, the point is different. There is a Christian thinking, lots of problems that Europe created, Europe were trying to solve for itself, but then it was a reference point, the background against which all these discussions happened. Okay? Okay. I suggest that we don't give so much space to only one person, because there was another gentleman. Huh?
Hi, so what Swami Vivekananda had told about caste system was, all the Chaturvarnas was, all were born as Brahmins.
All was born as Brahmins.
Huh?
Yes. Swami Vivekananda had told everyone at the beginning of the time, everyone were Brahmins, and then later on they were divided into caste, Chaturvarnas, that is Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. So the classification may be according to the work which they do or what things which they do in their life. If my memory is correct, Sage Bhrigu also had told in the similar manner. So even now, the same things are continuing. As in, the elite class of the society continues to be the elite class of the society. The leaders or whoever it may be are continuing in the same manner. So that is an observation which
okay,
came
it's
into
a comment.
My mind.
It's a comment, right? I will be very brief in this response. You are pointing to a direction of research that we consider as very important. That is what Varnas really were and how they function in Indian societies and traditions. The understanding of Varna system, what it really was, which we think is very different from this Christian originated story about caste system. Yeah, but see, I will give just the one word of warning to understand properly what Swami Vivekananda did, but there were many others, right? Like Dayananda Saraswati, Gandhi had many thoughts on Varna system. More traditional thinkers, you know, more traditional thinkers like Vaishnavas that I am a bit acquainted with had lots of thoughts about Varna. But much of good research should happen, you know, we should not jump to conclusions very quickly. We should do very careful research structured by very good questions. But yeah, you are right. I mean, that's one of the directions, how to start understand what Varna was in India. See, Varna and caste, yes. On one level, we can agree for the sake of discussion to talk about caste as Varna and just let's have an agreement that we use Portuguese word to understand Varna, that's possible. But then later on, whether we use this word or this word doesn't matter unless and until we have a good explanation of the whole concept. Which is a part of certain thought, you know, structure of thinking. So
Brahmins were not just classified as priests, but they were also teachers and they were also people with intellectual capabilities.
See, some of them were, but some of them were not. You know, we are having from Jaina resources, from Buddhist resources, and they do all kinds of things. There is a Buddhist story of a Brahmin who was doing a guard to the king. He had a shield and a sword, you know. What could he do? I mean, there was no scarcity of jobs, let's say, in modern times. We have an evidence, in fact, that from what I was able to gather, that Brahmins did all kinds of things throughout history, and the same is happening today. Okay. Yeah. Oh, who is first? Now I got lost a bit. Uh-huh.
How do you see the Aryan invasion theory in this regard? However, this is a foreign European concept. We disagree with it.
I think a large number of these issues
Yeah, because we spend a lot of time discussing what time is left, in fact, for. So my suggestion is that in the book that is hopefully still circulating, you will find a chapter of our colleague Marianne Kappens. You can read that. Some of the things will start in the roundtable discussion today. We will briefly introduce this question. Because it's another huge discussion. Sorry, you might feel now a little bit brushed off, but it's a huge discussion, needs several explanations, how certain problems emerged, what is really that is discussed, and the things. But, so, yeah. So,
in India, or it was brought to India over the seas from different countries. I think I'll make part of the third group and partially believe with the first gentleman who made his point out here. Don't you think that all this actually basically originated because of the lack of dignity of labor and later got its self-connected, you know, later it's, I strongly believe that it was because of the lack of dignity of labor which the whole caste system, the whole Varna system actually happened. And one more thing I would like to clarify here is many of the texts, many of the preachings actually believe that religion is something really different from what actually caste system is. Because religion focuses more on the type of preachings and the type of leaders you would want to honor and the kind of ideals you would want to follow. Whereas the caste system is more restricted to these social status quo. So don't you feel like what actually, at least in the practical scenario of the modern globalized world, what is actually making a difference is the fact that there is a lack of dignity of labor in the country, which is responsible for making the system fail to understand the fact that there has to be a dignity of labor first instilled in the whole society. I strongly believe that if the government or the system had been able to provide the same sort of status, like the same, okay, this might be a sensitive issue, but in case the government of our country had actually taken a step to understand the, understand and revise its policies of reservation and other things. So probably that would bring down the space between the status quo and the, you know, it would probably improve the dignity of labor, and that would actually in turn make sure that there is no much difference between the caste groups, the so-called caste groups in the country.
Because of lack of time, my response will be very short. First, we are saying there is no caste system. And we tried to explain how all the idea emerged. So we are not thinking really that this is a good way how to approach the problems of India today. Very short, you know, there is no caste system in India. Second issue, you should think properly how all these problems you are describing as not labor not having enough dignity or opportunities are or are not connected with jati. Because automatically it doesn't occur to me at all. There are all kinds of problems that labor faced in Europe and is facing, all kinds of problems that workers are facing in the United States, everywhere in the world. So just two brief comments, because Dr. Jalki is telling me time is short, okay? Hey, yeah. Perfect.
The curricular part is the PhD part and the main job was
yeah.
The second class, the
yeah.
class.
Yeah.
So that probably has created an impact on the mind that all of this is basically really connected to the occupation, more with the occupation and less to the religion.
Thank you very much, because now you started to pay attention to the source of the problem, textbooks. See, what are the textbooks based on? Orientalist research. So? Please be careful about the textbooks. Why should they be telling you the truth about the world? They have so many problems without textbooks home, there are so many problems in textbooks everywhere. So unless and until you have a clear idea how the theories and explanations described in textbooks are telling you something valuable, just be careful. It is believed. It's believed in Europe. It's believed in India. This is exactly the problem. Exactly the problem. But our problem is that this is blind belief, you know, that poses itself as a result of scientific research. That's our problem.
I got my with the last
one. Okay, good. Very good research question. This is very, yeah?
Because I think it will take more time for, Martin to answer these questions. Can we take them up? I think please keep the questions. These are wonderful questions. And we need to grapple with them. My suggestion is that I think there are many people who have worked in this area. They should be able to answer this question. We'll take that.